You probably do know audiobooks, but do you also know audio plays? This is something that was, at least in the German-speaking area of Europe, a big thing during the 80s and saw somewhat of a comeback after the 2000s. German label Europa, today a subsidiary of Sony Music, is certainly the most well-known hereabouts, as they published many dozen of audio play series over the years, some of which are still running since the 80s to the present day. While Europa also did the audio play adaptations of popular film and TV series like James Bond, Back to the Future, Knight Rider, The A-Team, Airwolf and many more, they also produced series like The Famous Five, aka Die Fünf Freunde. Now, with my children getting into the age, we started to get into audio plays. Of course, I would never give them my precious 40 years old audio cassettes. But still, I'd like them to at least listen to those old audio plays the way I experienced it in my own childhood. I'm a bit nostalgic, but these tapes featured the music of German composer and musician Carsten Born. The music had been replaced from any re-releases since like 35 years ago due to the legal dispute, and ever since, these plays feature, amongst others, the music of German composer and musician Jan Friedrich Konrad. While I do like his work as well, I'm really used to Carsten Bohn's music for those classic plays.
This is all well and good, audio play nostalgia, but what does this have to do with vintage computers?
Everything, as today I'm going into digitizing those old audio cassettes. And I'll be using this Silicon Graphics 02 workstation from 1996 to do that.
If you think this data machine will deliver a good result.
Well, the O2 workstations typically had been used for multimedia productions and were also often found in TV studios, so it should be fully up to the task. It's Christmas time. I'm the Vintage Collector and these are my short Advent time stories. To get a clean recording, I'll be using this hum filter in between the O2 and the cassette deck. As a showcase, I'll be using SGI Irix's own media recorder. It can be used for audio and video capturing, and in this case, I must configure it to capture audio as 16-bit and 44 kHz wave audio. Before starting the actual recording, I'll be rewinding the cassettes a few times. This is just to prevent any ruptures, as the tapes can become sticky over the years. And then, let's roll. As a comparison, I tried taking a recording with my MacBook, but apparently it doesn't have a line input. So I tried those two audio adapters, which I found in my stocks. But as you see, these are using USB Type-A connectors, so I had to try a USB-A to USB-C adapter. Still, I wouldn't be happy with this, as both adapters only offer an analog microphone input but no stereo line in. I would need to use a full-blown sound card or music interface on the Mac instead to do a stereo capturing.
What was that?
That's news from our sponsor today, PCBWay. This December they're bringing the holiday cheer with their special Christmas event running from December 12th to December 31st. Free coupons to save on your next PCB project, free Christmas PCB prototypes, because nothing says festive more like a custom designed board. And my favorite, unboxing blind boxes. Who doesn't love a bit of mystery during the holidays? Head over to PCBWay.com and check out their Christmas event before it's gone. Now, while the O2 is doing its recording, I thought to quickly hook up this Sony Walkman via 3.5mm audio cable to my modern Windows machine. Also, I took a recording on this SGI 230 workstation, which I had featured in an earlier episode. In the meantime, I had equipped the Canopus DV Raptor expansion card into that machine so it could be used for DV capturing. For the sake of this video, I abused it for audio capturing. We'll look at the results in a few moments.
Ganz meine Meinung, Julian. Zuerst schleichen Sie so schön langsam dahin. aber dann rasen sie im Galopp vorbei.
Timmy gibt dir auch recht, Anne.
But first, here's the audio I captured on the SGI-02. While it's possible to install Audacity onto Irix, it's just a very old version, and as you can see here, there seems to be some issues with the GUI styling. I'm not in the mood to bother with that for the time, so I moved all my files over to my file server so I can edit them from my Mac. And for those who remember my previous video on Super 8 film restoration, one thing is for certain, any captured audio must be edited to shine. So what I did was to cut the raw recordings into new segments so I can edit one episode after the other. You may or may not have some background noise. You can get rid of it by selecting it from an otherwise quiet segment and apply the noise reduction filter. Furtherly, I was also cutting away any excess segments at the beginning and the ending of the tracks. One thing that easily happens with audio tapes is speed misalignment. Here you see my captured raw track compared against the same track ripped from a CD. Now, by selecting given segments and comparing their individual length, it's possible to calculate the speed difference. It would be too simple though to simply take the overall track length, because as mentioned, the music had been replaced and so the audio play was remastered. Luckily, the intro music remained the same, so it makes a good indication on how much speed difference we have. And as you see, the tape runs too fast, with around 3% difference from the CD speed reference. There's two ways to correct this. If you don't want to change the audio pitch, use the change tempo filter. But since I have an audible pitch difference between the two, I'd rather use the change speed and pitch filter. Now listen in on to how this sounds. So the pitch is about right now, but it still feels a bit dull, doesn't it? Let's compare the audio spectrum from the CD track. And here's the one from the captured cassette. The thing is, an audio cassette is a rather bad medium, and the older they get, the worse it becomes. Also, the dynamics range is limited when compared to a CD, so we will never get back studio quality. You simply can't add what's not there anymore. But I can still try to improve the audio levels a bit using the equalizer. For certain, I want to increase the treble a little bit, but also tweak those frequencies here so the spectrum of the tape recording will be shaped a bit closer to our CD reference. Now listen to what this sounds like.
Ich weiß, wie man mit bösen Hunden umgeht. Ich weiß, wie man mit bösen Hunden umgeht. Ich weiß, wie man mit bösen Hunden umgeht.
Not too bad, huh? So what about the comparison against the other captures? Apparently, the Walkman was more accurate in speed, as I didn't have to apply any speed correction at all. And here you see the spectrum analysis coming from the Sony Walkman recording I took on my Windows machine. It's not too bad if it weren't for that weird spike in the 20 kHz area. Also, I must annotate that the connection went from the headphones jack directly into the line in, without the humming filter in between. So the levels are definitely different as for the stationary tape deck that was connected to the O2, where we are talking line level recording. The O2 spectrum doesn't generally look too different. The levels are lower because of the mentioned line level recording. But there's no trace of this peak in the 20 kHz area. On the SGI-230 with the Canopus DV Raptor, the peak in the 20 kHz area is much less prominent than in the recording from the Walkman. And although I was recording from the same stationary tape deck and even the humming filter applied, the level seems to be stronger. Now, maybe I should retake the recording as the DV Raptor feeds in the audio signal directly into the internal sound card, so I guess there was some extra amplification happening. If anything, this peak here may be either some kind of distortion or noise, or just to point at the O2's DAC, which is a 16-bit DAC, the analog device's AD1843. On the other side, the SGI 230 has a Creative Labs Sound Blaster PCR 128, the CT4750, which seems to have a 24-bit DAC. And my Windows machine? It has a Realtek ALC1220 SoC on board, which seems to have a 24-bit DAC as well. Of course, none of the gear I have, except for the O2, is or ever was professional multimedia gear. For the SGI 02, there was even extra add-in boards which added 24-bit DACs as opposed to the default AV1 and AV2 boards. Maybe I should use the SGI Octane 2 then for capturing, as it seems to have a 24-bit DAC as well. But does it really matter, as I'm capturing from audio cassettes? The thing is this, a 16-bit DAC can easily cover a signal-to-noise ratio up to a theoretical maximum of 98 dB, whereas a typical audio cassette will be in the 60 to 70 dB range. And furtherly, even so a higher spec DAC may allow to record a higher sampling rate, like 96k or even more, a 16-bit DAC is just fine to capture a 44 kHz sampling rate. Even with the best audio cassettes, you'd barely exceed 18 kHz. So following the Nyquist theorem, the folding frequency is twice the interval between samples. That said, a sampling frequency of 44.1 kHz is good to capture a spectrum of up to 22 kHz. That's more than enough for a 40 years old audio cassette. Audiophiles would maybe disagree with what I'm saying, but we're talking audio cassettes containing adventure tales here. Come on. Said that, here's one not to be taken too serious, but more like a gag. More by coincidence, I got hold of this micro cassette player. While I don't have any particular use for it right now, I took the time to transfer some of my audio plays over to the three micro cassettes I had. Of course, I had to downsample, so it sort of works with the 8 kHz spectrum these cassettes have. It's worth noting that Sanyo brought a hi-fi tape deck in the 80s for microcassettes, though given the ordinary audio cassettes run at 80 cm per second, which translates to aforementioned roughly 0 to 18 kHz frequency spectrum, these microcassettes transport the tape at 2.4 cm per second, cutting the spectrum down to said 8 kHz. But as I said, it's a gag, a functional one nevertheless, more like an homage to the original audio plays I have and sit side by side with them in my exhibit. Tell me, have you been into archiving old analog tapes and what was your experience with it? And did you, by coincidence, own the Sanyo Hi-Fi microcassette player? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my Advent Time story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again tomorrow.